Good morning, everybody, and a very warm welcome to Glenwood online gathering today. How are you, Paul?
I'm very well, thank you.
Good.
This week,
good.
Because it's only Wednesday.
It's only Wednesday.
I know, but I'm doing well by Wednesday, so that's good.
Good.
And how are you?
Yeah, very well, thank you.
Can I say? Can I say I'm liking your new style?
Well, I think next time you see me, I'm perhaps I'll have a skinhead. Like, I can't stop. I'm going shorter and shorter and shorter.
Well, we could do it together then, couldn't we?
Yeah. It wouldn't be too much of a shock for you, though, would it?
It wouldn't be too much of a shock. The shock
getting
would be...
less and less of a shock for me.
Yeah, I should have had a hair transplant years ago.
Yeah, perhaps you should do that instead.
I could, couldn't I?
Yeah,
like Austin Healey, rugby player. He had a hair transplant,
okay.
As did Wayne Rooney.
Really?
Yes. I don't know how we got onto this.
I feel like I learn a new thing every time we record one of these services.
So tell me, I gather you went physically as opposed to philosophically to Coventry.
Yes, my sister was ordained on Sunday. Yes, it really was wonderful, actually. It was a really, really special day and service. And
mind you, they're long services, aren't they?
Long service, and we were glad of magazines, and David took the boys out in the middle, but... Yeah. It was actually really powerful, actually. Mm. Yeah, it was. I think as well, when you're there and you're invested in it, I think it does go quicker as it was, and it was. Yeah, it was a really lovely. It was a really lovely celebration.
Fantastic. Yeah, so, yeah. Is she a reverend, a priest?
So she's a curate.
A curate.
So she's going to be a curate in a church in Coventry for the next 3 years.
Gosh.
She's got this fabulous house.
Has she?
They've given her, yeah.
The vicarage.
Fabulous. Well, it's a... So the vicar is in the vicarage, but there's another house.
Curate's house.
Yeah.
Curate's egg.
Yeah, exactly. It's not actually called that.
No, it's not called
that.
Called the nest. Curate nest. No, anyway, move on.
But yeah, no, I think she's going to be really happy there. They seem really lovely people.
Good.
So that's good.
I'm really pleased.
Yeah.
It's great.
And they're lucky to have her as well.
They are lucky to have her. She's anything like you.
She's better than me.
I doubt that's possible. So this week, actually, we're doing something slightly different with the service. We're going to be looking at one of the charities in the faith community. So we've got Glenwood Church, we've got Hope Trust, Social Action Trust, and also then we've got Going Public, which is the creative arts side and the internship side. And so we're going to be looking at a bit of that. Meg and Laura, Bradford and Laura Churchyard, will be taking part a bit later on.
Great.
So it's great. And normally this time of year, when we're meeting in person, we would have had a celebratory service for the interns. And we are going to hear from Laura Churchyard and from Kelly next few weeks and months.
Yep.
But first off, they came across, they dusted down the archives, and they came across this video, it's only about a minute long, a promotional video we did for Going Public back in the day when I had a bit of hair.
I cannot wait.
So this is that video.
I cannot wait. Enjoy, everybody.
And we've come tonight, we just want to talk about an issue which is very important, that's the issue of sex and sexuality. And we hope that through the video, through the music, through the drama, through what I have to share, will challenge you, will provoke you, it will make you think.
Paul, you know, it is a bit of a shock seeing that hair, isn't it, really?
It is a shock.
We're all used to you looking like this now.
What used to be. I mean...
But lovely to see all those faces from the past.
It was lovely to see all those faces from the past,
actually. Lots of people have been involved in Going Public over the years.
It is, and sadly, obviously, Rob Blasey no longer with us.
Yeah.
He was a great inspiration. But it's great to see, actually. And one of the things Going Public are committed to, obviously, is schools work. And back in the day when I was doing it, it was more to do with sex and sexuality and relationships and value and all that. But now they've developed more still do that, but also about mental, emotional well-being.
Okay.
Which obviously with the pandemic, even more so.
There's such a lot of pressure, isn't there, on people's mental health and mental well-being. Mm. And, you know, I think that it would be remiss of us really at this point not to sort of say, you know, that actually if you are struggling with your mental health, it's a really brave step to go to the GP and speak to the GP.
Absolutely.
And speak to somebody as well, you know, that you trust. And actually that's something that's very brave to do, and it's not something to be ashamed of at all.
Absolutely.
That's the brave step, and shouldn't be considered anything else.
You know, I mean, it is the hardest step is to ask for help.
Absolutely.
It really is the hardest step.
Yeah.
But it's the best step as well.
Mm.
If I'm not mistaken, you from time to time struggle a bit with anxiety, is that right?
Yeah, low grade anxiety, I would say. But and there are definitely things that sort of I've done to or learned over the years to sort of help with that. And one of them definitely is speaking to trusted friends. Mm. And sharing with people. And, you know, I'm fully supportive of antidepressants, going to see a GP. Mm. That's not actually something that I've ever done yet, but, you know, fully support that.
Mm. Yeah.
You know, some of the things, I think there is a bit of a sort of wellness self-care industry now.
Yes, there is. Yes.
Which I think it is sort of important to sort of... To be aware of, and not necessarily to sort of give all of our money to.
No.
But at the same time, there are some really helpful things that we can all do that can, because actually we're all on a continuum of mental health, and there are things that we can all do that can sort of help us, you know, learning some of the breathing exercises, going and getting a glass of water, you know, spending some time outside.
And an open field, shouting at the top of your voice,
that's
screaming.
That's right, release
it's quite cathartic.
Absolutely. I've done that before.
Yeah, I've done it.
I've done it. And it's really very helpful.
It is, isn't it?
It is. That's not to say any of those things sort of supersede, you know, getting medical help.
Absolutely.
But they can be really helpful, actually, to help us all sort of regulate, I suppose, our mental health. Yeah.
And one of the things I love about the Psalms, for example, is when I began to read them through the eyes of somebody who has gone through mental, emotional well-being issues, you suddenly begin to realize that quite a few of those Psalms are written by people who clearly suffer from depression. You can just sense it in a psalm. And they're helpful because it legitimizes it. And it resides with the spiritual context.
Yes, absolutely.
So you don't have that stigma.
No, David feels really passionate, actually. And I agree with him, but he sort of talks about this a lot, about the importance of recognizing the lamentations that happen in the psalms. And actually really taking note of that and not just looking at the Bible and thinking, oh, it's all... You know, everybody in the Bible is joyful, joyful, joyful all the time. Mm. People do cry out to God, and that is a legitimate expression, it's important to give space for that.
It is, it is, absolutely. And Megan and Laura, who are part of the Going Public team, amazing being able to visit two schools
this term,
and went in for 5 days for each one. And Meg now is just going to talk a little bit about Going Public and the work she particularly does in relation with theatre in education, and schools work.
Hello, my name is Megan and I head up the theatre and education arm of Going Public. We are passionate about using our gifts and our creativity to bring hope, particularly to the area of mental health. This year obviously has looked very different for all of us. For us, it's meant that we've not been able to go into schools in person and deliver presentations. So instead, we developed some videos to encourage families and children at home. If you have seen any of these videos on Facebook or on YouTube, you will understand why I have inadvertently become known as the Bee Lady. In fact, I visited a school a couple of weeks ago, and as soon as the children walked in, one of the girls popped their hand and said, "Sir, isn't this the Bee Lady?" And then they all started chatting and remembering from when I delivered Be the Best Me to their year group 2 years previously. So actually, I was really impressed that they remembered. Be the Best Me was developed to promote community and kindness. A school approached us and asked us to explore these topics. Recently, thanks to a grant from Just So, we were able to digitize this presentation. It's usually a theatre show. We were able to produce a film version of it that we'll be able to offer to schools from September, which is really exciting. Hopefully it'll be a really useful resource for them, particularly in the wake of the pandemic. So I thought you might like to see a snippet of this new film. And for those of you who didn't understand previously why I'm the Bee Lady, maybe you'll understand after seeing this. So here's a snippet from Be the Best Me. Enjoy.
The top job in a beehive is the queen bee. The queen bee's responsibility is to lay thousands of eggs that will grow up and become bees and keep the hive going. The way that a queen bee becomes a queen bee is by eating royal jelly all day long. Now, can you imagine a better job than that? Just eating jelly all day long. And I bet it's the best kind as well, royal jelly. Fit for a queen.
Morning, hive. You worker bees are doing a simply marvellous job. I just wanted to congratulate you. Wait one moment. What do you lot think you're doing sitting on your bottoms? Get to work immediately or I'll chop off your wings.
Oh, she was a bit bossy, wasn't she? I think somebody needs some more royal jelly in her belly. What's next? There are lots of jobs for the worker bees to do in a bee colony. For example, foraging. Now, forager bees are the ones that you'll see buzzing around the place. It's their job to go out of the hive and find that sweet nectar and sticky pollen. They'll bring it back to the hive to make, can you guess? Honey, that's right. A very important job.
They can fly for up to 6 miles and as fast as 15 miles per hour. Not bad for a tiny bee.
Neom!
What's next? Oh! Builder bees! Now, builder bees make beeswax to build the wax comb. Now, wax comb is like six-sided shapes, hexagons, stacked on top of each other to make a wall of cells.
Yeah, nah, don't worry about a thing, darling, all right? I'll get this hive up and running for you in no time. Traditional wax comb design, yeah? Yeah, yeah, no problem. Oh, would you look at that? It's raining. We don't work in the rain, sorry, darling. Nah, we don't. Ah, but look, don't despair. I'll go put my feet up. Get us another brew, will you, darling?
I beg your pardon.
Where there are builders, you also need cleaners. Cleaners, they're responsible for cleaning out those empty cells, ready to store the nectar or the pollen or make a home for the new baby larvae.
The queen bee will inspect these cells and if they aren't up to her standard, they'll have to clean it again.
Right, so we've had the queen bee, the forager bees, the builder bees and the cleaner bees. Oh, I know what we're forgetting. The nurse bees.
Nurse bees look after the baby larvae and make sure they are fed. They check on the larvae up to 1,000 times a day, so they are kept very busy.
The coolest thing about nurse bees is if the hive gets an infection, the nurse bees will actually prescribe a very special
special type of honey. Now, this honey is full of antibodies, which means that the bees can fight off the infection and the hive will get better. Amazing! My favourite role of all of them in a beehive has got to be the bouncer bees. They're actually called the guard bees, but I like to call them the bouncer bees. They protect the hive from unwelcome intruders like robber bees and predators.
If you ain't on the list, you ain't coming in.
Isn't it amazing that every single bee in a bee colony is given a very special job to do? Every job is important, which means every bee is important. Every single one is valued. I wonder what bee role you would pick if you lived in a colony.
I wonder if you learnt anything new about honeybees there. If I'm honest, I quite enjoy being associated with bees now. Bees are amazing. For such tiny creatures, they make a huge impact. Bees pollinate the food we need to survive, and many of the trees and flowers that provide habitats for wildlife. Pollination is a vital ecosystem service. I think God delights in bees. I know God delights in every single child we have the privilege of speaking to. It is a joy to share with children and young people that, just like bees, they are not insignificant. They are important. They are valuable. Their life has purpose and meaning. Our latest project has been producing some pre-recorded lessons that will help children process the experience of lockdown and support their emotional well-being in the wake of the pandemic. Please would you pray for us as we prepare this new resource and get ready to distribute it to schools. Please would you also join us in praying for every child who receives these lessons, that they will know their worth, they will know they are valued, and they will know something of God's love. And if this message excites and inspires you, if you are passionate about young people knowing their worth, if you want to know how you could get involved, please get in touch. We would love to hear from you. Well, all that's left for me to do now is buzz off.
I've tried to stand my ground, I've tried to understand, but I can't seem to find my faith again. Like water on the sand or grasping at the wind, I keep on falling short. So please be my strength. For a place where I can plant my faith, one thing I know for sure, that I cannot create it and I cannot sustain it. It's your love that's keeping me. So please be my strength. Please be my strength, 'cause I don't have any. My final breath, I hope that I can say I fought the good fight of faith. I pray your glory shine in this doubting heart of mine, and all would know that you are my strength. You are my strength. Back home. You are my strength.
that song really was wonderful. Thank you so much, Josh, for all you're doing to help with these services. And your big shout out to Jessie as well, little baby Jessie. I don't know whether we've mentioned Jessie before.
No, haven't.
Oh, baby Jessie.
I know. I actually saw baby
Very
Jessie.
Very excited.
Yes, I went up to, it's not Morganstown, it's
Tongwynlais. Yes.
And Josh opened the door with a little Jessie.
Oh, isn't he gorgeous?
Yes.
I mean, Jessie.
Yeah. anyway, be the best me.
Yes. So I wanted to say that Meg had sent us a preview. I think she'd sent an email around for people to sort of give her feedback.
She did, on Be The Best.
And on the Be The Best Me video that she'd produced. And our boys watched it and they absolutely loved it. I mean, they were proper belly laughing.
Oh, wonderful.
And afterwards as well, they sort of didn't really want it to end. And so we ended up getting pieces of paper out and they were drawing different types of bees.
Isn't that great?
Yeah, it was brilliant. It was really brilliant. And we were asking them different questions. They were she's very, very talented. They all are actually in Going Public. We're very, very lucky in Glenwood to have all of the Going Back Public staff, past and present.
Absolutely. And there has been, and past and present is a very good phrase actually, because I'll share a little bit more when I share a bit later. But Going Public started way back in 1990 when you were, how old were you?
Four.
And what's been great about Going Public, it's morphed and we've had many different people being part of it and they each bring something different to it and each develop something. So
fantastic.
Moving on from the school's work that I did early on and then Ali brought the theatre company to it and it just developed and grew. And now Meg and Laura Churchyard and Laura Bradford and others, Deb Tugwell, Amy have all been part of Going Public in the last year and it's been great. And so you're just about to pray. After you've prayed, we're going to have a reading from Laura Churchyard, who's been working with Going Public for this year and done a great job considering COVID.
Amazing, yeah.
And then we're going to hear from Laura Bradford about the internship. Laura is, as we know, Glenwood's youth worker, and she's given, she works 3 days a week for the church, and then she's going to work 1 day a week for Going Public, developing our internship program, and she's going to talk a little bit about the internship program. So after you prayed, that's who we're going to hear from.
Fantastic. Yeah, Lord God, we do thank you that you are with us. And we thank you that you love us. And we thank you as well that you want good things for each one of us. And we do pray for all of our mental health. We thank you for the work that Going Public is doing to give young people confidence to be aware of their mental health and where they can go for support. And we do bring our whole selves to you. And we pray, Lord, that that you would show us and guide us and give us courage to ask for help when we need to, and to seek medical help when it's necessary. And we thank you that is part of sort of the strength that you give us, that we can come to you and you can give us that courage to go and seek help. We just lift up every single person who is watching this service and we pray blessing over them.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
The disciples had been fishing all night, but hadn't caught anything. When the sun came up, they saw Jesus standing on the shore and he said to them, "Good morning, did you catch anything?" They answered, "No." So he said, "Throw the net off the right side of the boat and see what happens." They did what he said. All of a sudden, there were so many fish in it, they weren't strong enough to pull it in. When they got out of the boat, they saw a fire laid with fish and bread cooking on it. Jesus said, "Bring some of the fish you've just caught. Let's have breakfast."
It's great to be working for Going Public, and our heart for this 18 to 25's internship programme is that it is an echo of the story in John 21, read just before by Laura Churchyard. In this story, the disciples are busy fishing on the lake, and Jesus is on the shore preparing breakfast for them, on a fire with some bread and fish. Now, I love this story, not just because it involves a fire, and I do love a good campfire, but also because Jesus, despite having the ability to provide breakfast, invites the disciples too to bring some of the fish that they've caught. This shows the kind of relationship that Jesus is having with the people around him. He wants to engage in a dialogue with them, for them to bring their gifts to the table. He recognises that what they have is of value. And this is the heart of the Going Public internship, to encourage young people to bring their gifts to the table and to use their gifts to serve others. And we've been so grateful to Kelly, Jacob and Churchy, who have served us so faithfully this year, despite the pandemic. And we'll be hearing a little bit about their time with us in the next couple of weeks. And as we continue to invite young people to come and join us as the Glenwood Faith Community, it will be an invite that echoes John 21. An invite to join us as we learn to listen and respond to Jesus. To join us as we receive Jesus's invite to the campfire, and to join us as we bring our gifts to the table and discover new ones. It's been a challenging year with COVID, hasn't it? And we would really value your prayers as we respond to the need, as we work to encourage well-being, build resilience and nurture faith. And so, how are we going to do that? What's the content of this internship program going to be? What are we going to do day to day? Well, it's all about discovering God and echoing God's heart. The psalmist writes, "Light, space, zest, that's God. And with him on my side, I'm fearless." And our internship programme is going to be based around those three ideas: light, space and zest. Light, as we discover more about faith and well-being through input workshops, gathering around the fire as a community to learn from one another. Space, using the wonderful backdrop of Wales, exploring spirituality, giving space to pray and practice spiritual disciplines. Zest, using their passion to serve, honing their craft, encouraging them to be generous with their creativity and skills. We're going back to the grassroots here at Going Public, serving the locality, people and place, and learning to notice God in the everyday. If you know someone who may be interested in this internship programme, then please be in touch and I'll post them a flyer. We'll be opening up this opportunity flexibly throughout this year.
Well, I hope that you will allow me a bit of license this morning as I talk, because I really want to talk a bit about going public and how it started, what motivated the start, because it's something that I was passionate about. And it was great to hear from Meg and from Laura about their vision and their passion for going public going forward. And that is so exciting. Every child, a young person, has a story to tell, and it's unique to them. We have a story to tell, and it's unique to us. And there'll be stories of pain and joy and disappointments and hope, of failures and of successes. And so here's the question. If you were to write the story of your life, if you were to write an autobiography, what would the first line of your story be? It's a great question, that, and unfortunately, I didn't think it up. It was a man called Patrick O'Toomer, and I was doing an online course with him. What would the first line of the story of your life? It's a great question. On February the 13th, 1987, I was still a youth worker for Glenwood Church, but I was ill on that particular Friday. I was home lying on the settee, wrapped up and feeling a bit sorry for myself. But I was watching the television, and an Open University program came on about English. Now, I cannot remember why I stayed with it, but they began to show and read a poem called The Seduction. And as I listened, I was pulled into this poem. And the result of this poem was from The Guardian and the BBC having a poetry competition for young people. And the winning poem would be printed in The Guardian and the BBC would make a film about it. And that's what I was watching. And the winning poem was by a 16-year-old girl called Eileen McCauley. And it's about a teenage girl and her story, her narrative. And it quickly became part of the GCSE English course. It's a fantastic poem. And the poem tells a story, a fictitious story, of a girl who goes to meet a boy, and they begin to go out, and he takes her to Birkenhead Docks, or to the docks in Liverpool, and one of the stanzas says this: he handed her a vodka and she knocked it back like drinking water. She giggled, drunk and nervous, and he muttered, "Little slag." And as soon as you hear that, you've got a sense of where this story is going. The poem explains how she feels, how isolated she feels, and it talks about how she's been bought and lied to by the images she's seen in magazines, and she says about it, cheated by the promise of it all in these magazines. And she becomes pregnant, and from her point of view, from her eyes and from her way she looks at her life, she has failed, and her life is a mess. And the final four lines are filmed in Liverpool as she walks between two, three high-rise blocks of flats, and it's grey and it's wet and it's miserable and the wind is howling, and you have this young teenage girl pregnant just walking in front of the camera. And she says this, so the poem says this: better to starve yourself like a sick, precocious child than walk through town with a belly huge and ripe. And better turn away, move away, fade away, then have the neighbours whisper, "She always looked the type." It's a fictitious story, but it's a story of many young people around the United Kingdoms. And the poem was about 7 minutes long, and as I listened to it and got drawn in, it's something in my stomach said, something's not right here. It's not right that so many lives are being broken and damaged by glossy images and presentations of value and worth and sex. And they were creating a narrative, a false narrative, and all of us at times get sucked in and seduced by it. And their narrative is very simple. They equate worth and value with how we look and what we wear and what jobs we have and how many social friends we have. And I remember a few years ago, Jane and I knew a young girl, and she came round to our house, and we'd known her for many years through Glenwood, and she said, "Come outside," and we came outside, and she said, "Look at this," and she got a brand new black BMW, and it did look good, I must be honest. But we knew what she was saying. She was saying, "Listen, I've been able to buy this. I bought what this world says is important. So if it's important, I must be valuable and I must be worthy." And that's the lie that is created by all these images. So many people at the moment are talking about Love Island, and I must confess, I don't get it. But the narrative that Love Island is a very simple one. It's not subtle, it's right in the face. It's the body beautiful, the perfect body, the six pack. And what they communicate is, if you look like this, you will get noticed. If you get noticed, you'll be valued, feel valued. If you feel valued, you'll feel of worth. And if you feel of worth, you might feel that you're loved. And social media posts that create the perfect image of life. Everybody but you and me seems to be living a great life, whereas the rest of us are not. And that's why I love people like in the Glenwood Faith community, like Simon Braybrook and Emma Dobson and Andy Williams and Abby Sutton, who either through the services or on social media have talked about mental health issues and emotional issues and painted a picture of reality, a narrative that's true, that people can identify with. So many lives, so many countless precious lives are being ruined by these lies. And most young people feel powerless to do anything about it. They don't know to what extent. I don't know to what extent it contributes, but the second biggest cause of death amongst young adults is suicide. And there must be a link somewhere between the false narrative and that tragic and sad outcome. And in the school presentations we went, I showed this video, the seduction video, the poem, every presentation, and we must have gone and spoken to about 150,000 young people over the years. And I can promise you, not a word of lie, every time we played that video, no matter how misbehaved the kids were, you could hear a pin drop, because that video connected with them. They recognized this was reality. The narrative that this video was telling was true, and they connected with it. It was almost like it was prophetic. And as I watched it, I sensed the whisper of God. And God said, why don't you try and do something about it? And so we did. And Joy Watts and I started going public. And we began with a national tour around the UK to Christian events. And it just overwhelmed us. We couldn't believe it. In Reading, thousands. In Cardiff, thousands. In Belfast, thousands. Just all around the country, there was this desire to hear a different narrative about value and worth. And from that, the school's work began, and then the theatre company, and then the internship. And it's just been a great ride and a great journey. And in the presentations and school's work, we looked at sex and sexually transmitted infections and body image. But above all else, we came to the place where we were able to share the narrative, tell the story of Psalm 139, we are fearfully and wonderfully made. To say to those young people, you are fearfully and wonderfully made. And Mark Maron, who's a comedian, wrote that every status, that is every Facebook post, every tweet, every WhatsApp, whatever, is just a variation of a single request. Would someone please acknowledge me? Would someone please acknowledge me? The universal cry to be valued and to be noticed. The need to be loved, the need to be valued, to have a purpose. These are universal, and they're not unique to young people. They're true of all of us, from the oldest person to the very baby who's just been born. And to share with these young people who may appear to be confident, but inwardly we know they are dying, that you are valued, you are loved, that your purpose is to become all that God intended for your life is a fantastic privilege. There were times when it was hard, I must be honest, standing up in front of 350 year 10 pupils, knowing you've gone for 3 hours, is quite an intimidating thought. And at times when I got tired, I thought, do I really want to keep doing that? But God gave me a verse in the early days from Proverbs 31, and it says this: speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves. Ensure justice for those who are being crushed. Yes, speak up for the poor and the helpless, and see that they get justice. And I knew that I had to keep going, because somebody needed to speak up for these young people, because they were voiceless. And the culture and the narrative they were in was crushing them, as that verse in Proverbs says. And they didn't have justice. So, for example, football's top of the agenda at the moment. Pressure on parents with football teams and football clubs that change their strip deliberately, intentionally every year. And it's expensive every year. And it's hard for parents when their children go on and on about them. Who's gonna try and fight that justice battle and get that sorted? And who's gonna challenge the false narrative? And it's one of the roles of the church to speak up and to stand for justice for people. But it's more than just young people who feel they have no voice. It's the poor, the marginalized, the refugee, the ethnic minorities. These people all feel powerless and have no voice. Did you know during this pandemic that amongst the pensioners living in the UK, the precarious financial situation that people not being able to cope, not having enough money to live amongst pensioners has gone up by 10%. That is 2.1 million pensioners now do not feel they've got enough money to live by with just the essentials. And yet at the same time, around the world, millionaires and billionaires have got wealthier. Something doesn't seem to be quite right about that. And who's going to challenge that? Who's going to speak up about that? And that is the role of roles of the church. And the Bible tells us you can judge a country, you can tell the moral value of a country by the way that it treats its elderly. I wonder what you think the moral value of Great Britain is at the moment. One of the hallmarks of the life of Jesus is the people he chose to spend time with. He spent time with the religious, he spent time with the wealthy, but by and large, the most time he spent with were women and children and prostitutes and tax collectors and lepers. And the reason he did it was deliberate, it was intentional. In the culture they lived, there was a narrative that these people were second-class citizens. They had no voice, they had no power, they had no value. And here's the King of Kings coming to them and saying, you are precious, you are loved. Before you were born, God knew you in the womb. You have value and God loves you. And it was a radical message and it was a liberating message. When the woman comes to the well and sits by Jesus, she was a woman who had four failed relationships and she was married to she wasn't even married to the fifth one. And her life must have been devastating. She would have been the joke of the village. And Jesus speaks to her and gives her value and love and worth and points her towards the living God who she encounters. Zacchaeus, the tax collector, who everybody hated, Jesus invites himself to a meal to explain to him that he's of equal value to anybody and that God loves him. And the whole of Jesus' life was this one message: you are loved, you are valued. Begin to live the way that God intended you to live. It's been a privilege to be able to share those messages and as around Britain in the schools. And my prayer is that as GP enters this new season with Meg and with Laura and with others, as they begin to look at mental, emotional well-being issues, that they begin to invest in our interns, that they will begin to see people encouraged, transformed by the love of God.
Well, it's brilliant to hear more about going public. And, you know, I think especially at the moment, it's really great to hear what they've been doing in this past year, because it's been so different, actually, the years past.
Yes.
And, you know, it's fantastic how they have been able to adapt what they're doing and produce new content and, you know, and prepare for the future as well. It's really fantastic.
It is, and it's been hard. I mean, like, you're down at the speakeasy. Mm. And of course, the way that you operate the speakeasy has changed completely over the past year.
Yeah.
And, but people, lots of charities have had to adapt and so it's great actually. And if you want to find out more about Going Public, you can go to the website, which is www.goingpublic.org.uk. And then YouTube.
That's right, you can subscribe to the YouTube channel. So if you go onto YouTube and then search for Going Public Cardiff, it should pop up and you can like and subscribe to the channel.
Then there's the usual social media stuff, isn't it? You can go to
Facebook, Instagram, I think Twitter.
Possibly Twitter, yeah. And you know, if you're interested, you can give online to Going Public. Please pray for Going Public, particularly internship. We're recruiting for September and January. We're going to have two start dates. So if you know anybody who's looking for something to do and they're in the 18 to 25 bracket, get in touch.
Mm.
That'd be wonderful, actually.
Yeah.
And then, Maddy's got one more thing. You should have had an email from me by now about coming in to help begin to tidy up and to clean, particularly in phase one, but those are the jobs. From Wednesday this week. So could you let us know? We have to have we're going to have a rota to bring people in. But there's a lot cleaning to do, so the more help we can have would be fantastic.
And also this week is the prayer meeting at 7:30 on Tuesday evening. An email will be sent to you beforehand with the Zoom link. So it'd be great if you wanted to join in with that as well.
Absolutely. And I think that is about everything for this week. So I think it's all it has to say goodbye.
Bye.
Bye.
Christ within me, Christ be.